Good morning, everybody. It's early morning, right? It's almost Friday. I think it was a great way to start the day, and I don't have a voice, right? So I need my beer. I hope that the work speaks by itself. I'll try to speak not that much, and then we focus and we concentrate on the work, and I'll try to do my best here. But anyways, it's a pleasure to be here. Thanks for the invitation. Thanks for having me. We love this partnership, and now I also learn a lot from you guys. And it's a real honor to be here today. So let's talk a little bit about our journey. And it's amazing to see here how can we break through with creativity and build winning brands. We're so proud of the brands we have. But exactly as we were just talking about, we need to make sure that our company, our business, and our brands remain relevant and remain winning brands, not only for the next 5 years, but for sure for the next 105 years, right? And then as consumers are evolving so fast every day, we need to keep up the pace to be up to speed with culture, with relevance, so that we can keep winning. And we're on a journey. So I'm very humble to say, I think this is a story that talks a lot about our culture. I think we're very ambitious as a company, but we're also very humble to understand that it's about time for us to change, for us to evolve, for us to come back to those times where creativity was the leading force taking us forward to the future, where building amazing brands was the most important thing that we could ever do as a company, and also bringing innovation as the center of everything we do. So actually, if I could summarize everything that is going on at Anheuser-Busch today, I could talk about three things. And this is a little bit of how I have organized our conversation this morning. One, it's all about putting people first. Of course, it's a cliche, I know, but the point here is not, our decision was not to try to find a fancier word for consumer centricity. The thing is exactly to take it seriously, right? We all know how things are changing fast, how consumers are evolving. In a country like the U.S., you see the mega trends making a difference in our industry, health and wellness, premiumization, purpose-led brands. That times all the demographic specificities that we have in this country, Hispanics growing, Asians growing, so on and so forth. It's so complex out there that we need to raise the bar big time in the way we interact and understand our consumers. This is why I like to say that we are becoming a people-first kind of company, because we need to go even beyond seeing consumers as consumers. We need to understand them as people, because this is when we get to understand their real motivations, which are the real opportunities that we have to create brands and products that will have a meaningful role in their lives. And just one of the examples of the things that have been changing internally for us to do a better job here, we've been really changing the way we talk to consumers. Instead of doing the traditional focus groups that we used to do years and decades ago, now, for example, we have an online panel of more than 6,000 consumers that we use every single day. So we have kind of a political campaign machine in-house, and we access more than 6,000 consumers every day, so that we can get to know them as people, so that we can talk to them about everything that we're doing. And then the second thing is exactly about creativity. Needless to say that attention is the new currency today. It's so hard to grab people's attention. So first we need to grab people's attention, then we need to make sure that whatever is the way we're trying to interact with those people will be meaningful to them. And therefore, more than ever, I think creativity is not only something that us from the creative or advertising or from the marketing industry love, but this is something fundamentally important for the business. Because either we use creativity to break the clutter and to make people pay attention to us and to welcome us into their conversations, or we are dead. So two of the most important things that we are really changing in the company now are putting people first and making sure creativity will not be something that people say, okay, this is for marketers, but will be something that people really celebrate and enjoy, because this is what makes sure that we will have a chance to be meaningful and relevant to people. The third thing is innovation, but let's see if we have time to get to that point in the end. I'm going to focus on people centricity and creativity today. If we have time, I have a few pages on innovation as well, exactly because we need to reshape, we need to renew our portfolio exactly to make sure that we'll be offering products that really meet consumers' needs and expectations in the world as it is today. So these are the three most important things that I do every single day, to make sure that we are become people-centric, to make sure that creativity will be one of the most important things for the entire company, not only for the marketing team, and that we will be best in class on innovation. So let's start the conversation. And of course, when you talk about creativity, there's a big effort inside for us to create a culture of creativity. I don't believe that we should just gather our agencies and say, you know what, we need creative work. This is a decision we make, and this is a process that needs to start from within. So we have a huge effort, a huge work stream internally to really create a culture of creativity. We're training people, we're changing the profile of the people that we have. We have a totally different routine so that we can make sure that creativity will be part of our everyday conversations. And then, of course, the more we harmonize our language and our vocabulary using creativity wheels like this, the more we can make sure that everybody is going to be speaking the same language every day. All right, so having said that, I just wanted to give you some background on the mindset, on the way we see things. And actually, on top of saying those three things that I said that are the North Stars for everything that we're doing, I think it's just important to close this introduction moment here just by saying one more thing, which is the real North Star that happens before anything else. We made the decision as a company not only to go to the office every day to protect our market share position, it's very cool to be the leading company in the beer segment. But one thing is to go to the office every day and say, okay, let's protect it. Let's make sure that we're going to manage the status quo. This is one thing. But we made a decision as a company to have a different mindset, to move from being a leader to really lead the conversation. We want this industry to grow, and we want to grow together. So we want to lead growth generation. So once we change the mindset, everything changes, because we need to go to the office every day to make an impact, to change behavior, to change the way people interact with beer and to the alcoholic environment as a whole. So that's the beginning of everything. It's a huge transformation for us as a company. Then to make it happen, we have those three pillars that I just mentioned. Focusing on people first, making sure creativity will be top priority for everybody in the company, not only marketing, and being best in class on innovation. So having said that, and because I don't have a voice, I prepared the material here today to share some of the work that we've been doing as a consequence of this new mindset that we have as a company, so that we can drive the conversation based on that. First, I'm going to show something for Budweiser. And this is very, I love this case, and Ricardo, the VP for Budweiser, is here with us today. I love this case because Budweiser, it is, on one hand, an iconic American brand. But on the other hand, Budweiser has been suffering in the last couple of years from this imagery of being low quality, mass produced. Because after the revolution of craft beers, people started to believe that the traditional macro breweries had no quality. So when you ask people, and this is important to the point on understanding people, not only consumers. If you talk to consumers, they say, Budweiser doesn't have quality. I'd rather have a new brand that I don't even know, but it's new. It comes from a small brewery. It's artisanal. It's handmade, right? So this is an absurd, right? So just to be clear, nothing against craft breweries. By the way, we own plenty of those. It's awesome. But this notion of big breweries don't have quality is an absurd. But it doesn't matter, because perception is reality. And then what do you do when you just react to consumers in a superficial way? You start doing a lot of quality campaigns. Brew the hard way. Let's talk about the ingredients. And let's talk about the product and everything. But then when you start to understand consumers as people, and then you see what's really behind what they say. And what they say is, I imagine Budweiser being fabricated. It comes from a factory. Brewed by machines, robots, just like General Motors makes cars. There's no humans there. That's what's really behind their perception. And then we started checking campaigns that would address quality versus talking about the product itself versus campaigns that would talk about people, that would humanize Budweiser, that would show that there are people behind the brand and that we care about people. And it was the most aha moment that I had in my, the biggest aha moment that I had in the last couple of years in my career, because the impact on the way they see the beer, when you humanize the brand without even talking about the beer, is amazing. It's much more effective than talking about the beer itself. So I love this example because it's all about really understanding people's motivations. And this is when you make a difference as a marketer to really transform the future of a brand. So I'm going to show some examples of how we are humanizing the brand under the new approach, which is Budweiser celebrates ordinary people doing extraordinary things. Let's see the first one, which is what we used for Super Bowl last year.
I'll be right there.
Now, the storm is affecting thousands of families, people still in desperate need of aid.
When the night has come.
Everyone, where are we at?
We've got hands ordered.
And the land is dark, and the moon is the only light we'll see. No, I won't be afraid. No, I won't be afraid. Just as long as you stand by me. So darling, darling, stand by me. Oh, stand by me. Stand by me.
Yeah, please, let's have some more volume. It's morning, right? You know, we have music. It's emotional. We need to create the right environment, right? So simply put, we have two parts of the presentation. The first part was designed to make you cry. So if we don't, we have an issue. And the second piece was designed to make you laugh. All right, so let's see if I accomplish the mission, right? But it's all about touching emotions. So I need some more volume. So again, this was a beautiful, I love this case. So instead of bringing the Clydesdales again, nothing against the Clydesdales, we love them, and they will always be back in what we do every now and then. But instead of doing more of the same, this is all about real people, real employees, waking up at 4 a.m. to stop producing beer and to put water into the cans to send it to people in need after all the hurricanes that this country had in 2017. And then when this guy comes back home and her wife looks at him like, "You're my man." Right? So it's like, yeah, so like this is real people. Everybody there, they're real employees. She is his wife. It's all real people. It's a real story. It's a real thing. Right? So this is when people say like, wow, this is my brand. This is my beer, you know? And then when you start asking them about the quality of the liquid, they say, wow, high quality, brewed with care. And so that's the big aha thing. So then we start, okay, it's awesome. Let's keep moving into this direction. Then I guess we have another case here developed by Dentsu. We have Dentsu here in the room as well. There you are, right? So it's super cool. This is something that we just released. It's a tribute. No? No, you're right, Jody. We have something before that. Sorry. This is something we did for Women's International Day. So on the left, you can see the Rio Budweiser campaign from the 60s. Right, so that was the role of a woman in that couple, right? Just to give support to the man. And then we said, okay, that was all right. So because we understand people, right, so we said, okay, it's time, it's about time for us to fix it. So we developed a series of ads coming back to the real ads that we did on the 60s, but we updated them with the current vision on the right, like showing what we really believe should be the right way for us to portray men and women in the world as it is today, or actually since forever it should have been like this, right? It was all about saying, we acknowledge, we made a mistake, let's do it better from now on. And this is how we introduced our partnership with See Her, which is something that we're very proud of joining. And Budweiser is going to keep talking about it again. It's all about human connection and how we are meaningful to people in a very genuine and authentic way. So getting to the point of being honest about the mistakes we did in the past. And then I'm going to show you now something that we just did, I guess, weeks ago, right, with Jackie Robinson. Jackie Robinson was the first African-American player at the MLB. So it was somebody that really made a difference in history. So when you talk about Budweiser celebrating ordinary people doing extraordinary things, This applies to our employees waking up at 4 a.m. to help people in need. This applies to great athletes, but we always focus on them in terms of the difference they made in the world as people, right? So let's see the case that we have for Jackie Robinson. It was a nice partnership that we built. Let's go. With Spike Lee, by the way. I guess I need another clip.
Jackie Robinson laid the foundation for America to see its black citizens as subjects and not just objects. It meant that there were 6 and 7 and 8 year old boys who suddenly thought a black man was a hero.
Is beer, right? So that's exactly the point. Instead of saying we're more refreshing, we're this and that, like if we think about beer, like what's the first thing that comes to your mind when you think about beer advertising, beer campaign, beer brand building, right? So this is beer, and this is all that we do, right? So I'm emotional when I see this thing. I'm very proud of it, and I think it's really cool. Okay, so let's see. I don't see people crying yet. So let's try one more time. Because we have another approach here that we did also a few weeks ago. Dwayne Wade, one of the most important NBA players, decided to retire. He's from Chicago. He's from Chicago. He was born in Chicago. But he was playing for the Miami Heat now, so he decided to retire. And he named his last season as the One Last Dance, right? So during his last season, he was swapping jerseys at the end of every game with the different players. And we decided to tell his story in a different way, following the same rationale, because we believed what he did as a person, not as an athlete, would deserve a chapter as well, and some other, and he could swap jerseys with different kinds of people too. So let's check it out.
I have no idea who's coming. Like, literally, no idea.
Hey, Hi, Dwayne. Hello.
Hello. How you doing, brother?
Pretty good, and yourself?
It's been about 12 years since I last seen you. I come from an area where not too many people make it.
It was always my dream that I'd get the chance to go to college, but we just didn't have the money.
You mean so much to us. And my brother Joaquin loved you from the beginning. He passed away in Parkland on February 14th. He was one of the 17 victims.
10 days before Christmas, our house burned down and we lost everything. It was one of the lowest points in my life.
Hey, Dwight.
How you doing, Mom?
You were the joy of my life, but I was dropping the ball. That day that I just couldn't do it no more was the day that I was gonna have to turn myself in. And I seen the tears just fall from your eyes. Your mama went down a road, Dwayne, that I didn't ever think I'd come back from. But on that road, I noticed you kept showing up. And you'll come and see about me. And Dwayne, because you believe in me. When I got out of prison, I was a different woman.
We received a phone call. Would you mind if Dwayne Wade take you and the family on a shopping spree? It just meant the world to me that you were there for us at this time.
Thank you.
You became our hero.
A lot of the words that you said hit a spark and kind of changed where I was going.
Without you and your full tuition scholarship, none of this would have been possible.
You're not Wade, the basketball player, the legend. You're the human being that took the time and on his own wrote my brother's name on his shoe, and you cared.
When you bought your mama that church, you don't even understand the lives that you changed. So I don't have a jersey, but I brought you this.
I don't have a jersey to trade with you, but I definitely have this. The blazer that I wore to my first job interview.
My cap and gown from graduation.
This is important because Joaquin wore this in his last championship. My family wanted you to have it.
Please don't forget my brother, Joaquin. Having you as a role model has made all the difference.
One of the special robes that you gave me, purple symbolized royalty, and you are royal in everybody's life that you've touched.
You completely changed the course of my life.
I know my brother is with you always.
It wouldn't have been possible to be here if it wasn't you.
I am more proud of the man you have become than the basketball player. You are bigger than basketball.
Mission accomplished. But this is it. So we're proud of this journey. It's a journey. We're still learning how to do this. But this is beer. Again, this is beer advertising. This is beer doing sponsorship on sports, right? It's been around since forever, right? But it's a totally different approach. And it's all about being relevant. Even I am almost crying. It's all about being relevant to people, right? So what encourages us on this journey is that instead of people reacting to what we do nowadays using their minds like, yeah, good, I'm going to try Budweiser now because it has less bubbles, because it's colder, because of this. People react to this saying, thank you. Thank you, Budweiser. Thank you for doing this. Thank you for reminding us that we're humans. Thank you. So it's a totally different kind of connection, right? And this is what creates what we talk about every day, which is brand love, right? But you need to do something about it. It needs to be genuine, and this is our journey. And then within this journey, it's awesome to see that, okay, it's a business, right? So it's cool, but Budweiser is making impressive, I didn't bring a lot of results here, like a lot of numerical pages, but the turnaround in terms of brand perception is huge, as I told you. Not only on brand love or preference or things like this, but when we talk about specific functional attributes of beer quality. Back to the beginning of the story, let's address the shadows, the issues of the brand. There is a major shift, because once people start to understand and to believe again that Budweiser is a human brand, that there are humans behind it, they believe that if we care so much about people, there's no doubt that we care about the beer we brew. And then they start to imagine Budweiser being brewed in a totally different way, and things start to change. So that was the case for Budweiser. And now let's try to touch different emotions, and let's talk a little bit about Bud Light. So now it's a different conversation. So Bud Light is a light beer, so it's all about bringing people together, social moments, for you to be with your friends, having a good time, right? Laughing, enjoying the moment, and everything like this. Again, it's super powerful. It's by far the most popular beer type in this country. Bud Light is by far the leading brand in the country. But again, a beer as big as this has this challenge of always being culturally relevant. Otherwise, you just become vanilla. And then when you become vanilla, people say that you don't have a good taste. Again, it all starts in emotions and how people perceive the brand. They articulate their perceptions via opinions on your product, but the origin is usually not on the product itself. So he said, okay, how can we catch up? This is a younger approach and everything. And then we said, you know what? Let's start speaking their language. Let's not try to convince them about, you know what, this is different because of this, because of that. We do have a chapter later in this story talking a little bit about the product, and I'm going to explain you why. But it all started by, if you want to start the conversation again, to reconnect with people, this brand needs to start speaking their language. And we all know that people are watching less television. People do watch live sports and everything, but people watch TV shows, TV series. People are getting used, especially that target group is getting used to episodes, to characters, to storytelling. So he said, okay, so why don't we create our world with our characters? Why don't we invite people to our world and we start engaging with them in a different way? And that's exactly what we did with Bud Light. People usually say, it's the Dilly Dilly campaign. It's not the Dilly Dilly campaign. Dilly Dilly is the language that we speak in their world. But we really did this. If you go to Wyden and Kennedy, you're going to see this in the wall. So there is a map. And then every time we have to do something, we say, okay, so let's do our next chat here. The Wizard is going to create new Bud Lights because Super Bowl is coming. Okay, now we're going to launch Bud Light Orange. Okay, so let's go to the Great Lime and Orange Groves because this is where we plant the trees and this is where the story starts. Now Super Bowl is coming. Let's go to the Coliseum. And then we really have places. We have a map. And this is the way we build this campaign is really not as a campaign. We don't do TV commercials. We do episodes. We have characters. So we started like almost 3 years ago, right? With the king, the queen. Then we brought last year's Super Bowl, the Bud Knight. To save everybody. We had four Hispanics on the World Cup, Oracle Susana, that was predicting all the results of the games and the matches. We have Rory, which is a representative of the people, the one that always says, yeah, pit of misery, dilly dilly. And Papa Moose, which represents fancy people. All the real people that are in real life saying, Bud Light's not good enough. This beer that I don't even know what's made of is much fancier. Right, so in our world, that guy's a villain, because in the Bud Light land, everybody's allowed to drink whatever they want, to hang out with whoever they want. Everybody's welcome, and fancy people full of judgments go to the pit of misery. So this is how we send our message to the world, but we mirror reality in that place, because that place is much funnier. That place is much more engaging. It's much more interesting, and this is when people start to reconnect with us. So, yeah, so we have a lot of episodes here. I mean, we've been doing this for almost 3 years already. And then we start from nothing in terms of social relevance and social conversation to being probably the biggest phenomenon that we had in this country in the last 2 years. So this really became terminology. We start to see people wearing Dilly Dilly shirts, saying Dilly Dilly every now and then. I encourage you, if you have time, to go to Google Dilly Dilly on a Christmas mass. You're going to see a priest celebrating the Christmas Mass, 100% of the sermon was all about dilly-dilly. To the point that he says, okay, you might be wondering now, well, what does dilly-dilly has to do with the birth of Jesus? But let me tell you what, it's all about saying to the people, be who you are. This is the beer of the people. It's okay for you to have it if this is what you want. No more cultural impositions from society. That's a priest celebrating the Christmas Mass. I really encourage you guys. It takes 17 minutes. But the guy talks about dilly-dilly on a church for 17 minutes holding a bottle of Bud Light. So take a look at that if you have a moment. So this is when you feel like, shit, there's something
the
going
Philadelphia
on.
Philadelphia Eagle.
I knew it would happen. And then, okay, so when these things start becoming so popular, then you have the real opportunity to be part of people's conversation in a very meaningful way. So I'm going to show you here something that happened in Philadelphia. So last year, the Eagles won the Super Bowl. But it was amazing. And again, it's all about paying attention to people and monitoring conversations. 6,000 people we talk to every day. So one day, Lane Johnson, one of their players, just tweeted, like, we never won the Super Bowl, right? So if we do, which for sure is not going to happen, right? I'm going to give away beers for the whole Philadelphia, for the whole city. And then Bud Light, it was on the radar. Okay, he spoke about beer, tweeted back, a simple tweet. Okay, Lane Johnson, beer's on us. It was as simple as that. And then suddenly, something started, and this is what I have here to show you. Here.
The Philadelphia Eagles weren't supposed to win the Super Bowl.
I don't see how they bounce back from this. They've now lost two at home.
The franchise had never won a Super Bowl before, and they were a 50-1 underdog at the start of the season. So when an Eagles lineman in training camp promised beer to the entire city,
if you want a Super Bowl, I'm giving out beer to everybody.
Bud Light stepped in and said, if you win, the beer is on us. Then something magical started to happen. The Eagles kept winning.
Bottom line, can they win a Super Bowl? They have a shot.
Eagles fans took our Dilly Dilly catchphrase and made it their own. They even named the Super Bowl winning play Philly Philly.
You want Philly Philly?
The Philadelphia Eagles are Super Bowl champions!
Now we owe an entire city free beer, and doubters began to question if we could actually pull this off. But we were ready. Moments after the game, we confirmed we would make good on our promise.
Now Bud Light says it is honoring the deal. We're gonna be giving out free beer at the parade.
Monday, we trafficked a full-page ad showing people where to get their free Bud Light. Tuesday, the mayor declared Parade Day, Philly Philly Day. Wednesday, we took out another ad letting those who couldn't make it to the parade know we still had them covered. And Thursday, at the parade, we even wrote Philly Philly in the sky. To keep the pressure on, we kicked off a full 360 program. We rolled out Philly Philly packaging, we released a limited edition Super Bowl championship pack, and we teamed up with the guy who started it all, Lane Johnson. We created a custom Eagles truck to deliver the pack. They sold out within 24 hours, and people even paid $700 for them on eBay. And we commissioned a bronze statue of the Philly Philly play, which is now a permanent fixture at Lincoln Financial Field. In the end, we generated more than 1.6 billion impressions, nearly 4,000 press stories, and over 245,000 social media mentions, which drove a 1.3 SharePoint gain in Philadelphia. But most importantly, Bud Light has become a part of Philadelphia sports history.
Philly, Philly!
So just to be clear, people paid $700 for a bottle of Bud Light, right? So again, that's the power of really touching people's emotions, right? And that was crazy. I'll never forget that because when the intern tweeted back beers on us, nobody would ever imagine what would happen, right? But this is how things happen today. You don't plan for everything. You need to pay attention to what's going on, and you go with the flow, right? That's a very important change in the mind of marketers. We try to foresee, to predict everything. This is not how things happen anymore. And then when they started winning, I remember Super Bowl day, the whole Bud Light team, we were at the stadium, and they were like, shit, they're winning. Shit, they're winning. Shit, they're winning. Shit, how what are we going to do? So we need to give away free beer for the whole city. Shit, they're winning. So nobody watched the game. And then after the game, they won. We were like, oh, my God. We went back to the hotel. And then I remember we had a big war room there. I said, people don't really expect us to do it, right? And then somebody from the PR team showed me that image that is in the video here. Like, no, take a look at this. And then people were crazy. They destroyed the whole city, by the way. Right? And they were free Bud Lights. So yeah, we'd better do something about it. But then again, you embrace it. And then it was awesome. So I think it was cool. All right. Then we said we challenged ourselves to go beyond that. We said it was awesome. You saw we started to grow share in Philadelphia again. But we said it's kind of easier to do something when a team and a city wins the Super Bowl for the very first time because the energy is there. Just one caveat that I have to make. In Philadelphia, Miller Lite is the leading brand. And Miller Lite is also the sponsor of the Philadelphia Eagles. Sorry. I should have brought here the images that we have of people taking Miller Lite out of the bars and putting back in the trucks during that thing. Okay. So he said, let's do something different. Let's push ourselves to work in a harder situation. Would we be able to do something with the team that is not winning at all? Because this is really to put his ability on test, right? And then we did this. That was the challenge to the team.
The next story combines two of my favorite things, football and alcohol. Bud Light has announced they will give Cleveland Browns fans free beer if the team wins a game this year.
Starting today, Bud Light is installing victory fridges that will be full of beer in Cleveland, 10 Cleveland bars. They're locked. When the Browns win their first regular season game, the fridges are unlocked and the beer is free.
In the history of promotions, they send out the signal, the chains drop off, and everybody gets free beer.
Streets are packed right now.
Did they open the Bud Light thing?
Oh, Billy, Billy!
And that meant one thing, free beer. Shortly after the win, the Bud Light victory fridges were unlocked at long last.
The stable screamed. They wailed because the Browns won. And honey, I'm talking for the first time since like Christmas Eve 2016.
Finally, people are enjoying what has been long overdue.
Well, now they're empty.
Seems like they were world champions, right? They won one game. The streets are packed, right? One game. And do you know how much it cost? It costed for us to do that? 10 fridges in 10 bars, period. 10 fridges in 10 bars. First thing that the quarterbacks asked after the game was over, the reporters came talk to him and said, did they open those fridges? Imagine the pressure and everything that was going on, right? So Bud Light made them win, right? Okay, so I think it was super cool. This is the model that we believe. It's a great example, again, on how you really become relevant to people by paying attention to what's going on, and you act many times with things that are not planned. So let's move. I guess I have something else here, because after a few years, Jody, what do I have now? Super Bowl? Okay, so this is the tricky piece. We said, okay, let's address something else that is really important in the light beer segment. When you talk to people, they believe the light beers are all the same, that there's no difference at all between Bud Light, Miller Light, and Coors Light. So it's a branding thing, which is okay, we're addressing that. But we said we can do more because we know that those beers are different. And so we said, okay, one, let's lead the industry on providing transparency to consumers. So Bud Light became the first beer in the industry to have nutritional labels on its packaging, because you all deserve to know what's inside the beers you choose. And then after doing that, we said, you know what? It's about time for us to talk about the differences between these beers to people. But only when you have a creative environment like this, you are able to talk about something as technical and boring like beer ingredients. And this is what we decided to do on Super Bowl.
And that's how you brew it.
My king, this corn syrup was just delivered.
That's not ours. We don't brew Bud Light with corn syrup.
Miller Lite uses corn syrup.
Let us take it to them at once.
But if something did happen, we'd eat the wizard first, right?
Yes. Oh, yes.
Oh, brewers of Miller Lite, we received your corn syrup by mistake.
That's not our corn syrup. We received our shipment this morning.
You're joking.
Try the Coors Light Castle. They also use corn syrup.
Can you smoke outside?
Oh, brewers of Coors Light, is this corn syrup yours?
Well, well, well. Looks like the corn syrup has come home to be brewed. To be clear, we brew Coors Light with corn syrup.
Ah.
Bud Light, brewed with no corn syrup.
All right. I'm gonna skip this one in a quicker way, because we're facing a federal lawsuit because of this. I'm not joking. So I don't even know if I was supposed to show it, because they filed a federal lawsuit because we are telling people that they use what they say they use, and they didn't like it. Okay, so let's move. The point here is look at the spike on search for corn syrup in Google. So this is all about making people aware and more conscious about the choices they can make when they decide the beer to choose, right? And from there we go. And then, because we always balance that message with the cultural relevance, this was the most flattering thing that happened to us. As you realize, our world, the Dilly Dilly world, is medieval. And then Game of Thrones reached out to us and HBO and said, it seems like we have a good opportunity to do a partnership. Right, and then we said, like, wow, it's a dream coming true, right? To get to that level of relevance where we can imagine having all those characters, ours and theirs, coexist in the same place. And we did that during Super Bowl as well.
It's a beautiful day for a joust.
Indeed. Sun's out. Got my lucky loincloth, cold Bud Light, comfy throne. I don't have the plague anymore.
Look, it's the Bud Knight.
Dilly dilly!
All right, let's tap this keg. Giddy up, Peanut!
So the final season is just about to end, and this will be the only moment when Game of Thrones did this kind of partnership with anybody ever, right? So this is again a testament of the relevance of this whole approach, right? It's all about speaking people's language, and then it was tough. And when we were talking to them, they said, "Okay, but then we need to kill the Bud Knight." I said, no, we cannot kill our hero, right? But this is, again, the change of mindset. Like, this is what makes people talk about it, right? And for those of you fans of Game of Thrones, you know that all the key characters, they die, right? They die. They just die. You need to embrace it. And many of them come back to life. But again, this is what's cool, right? Because when people talk about it after he was dead, a lot of people are saying, shit, he's dead. What about now? You should bring the wizard. Do something about it. So what's going to happen now? And then actually was a huge opportunity to keep engaging them in amazing conversations. Like we had some in memoriam videos for people to cry over their beloved Bud Knight, right? We even shared his. Anyways, we even shared his testament, right? His will on social media and everything. So actually, this created a lot of conversations. And then, of course, when the final season of Game of Thrones really started, we brought him back to life.
Nidi di rondine, risoni torti, quadretti eliche, bucatini, farfalle. Gnocchi, orecchietti, macaroni, tortellini.
Wait, are you just naming pasta varieties?
Yes.
You want to grab something to eat?
Yes.
Ciao.
I could go for some Italian.
So it was as simple as this, and he got everybody talking about it back, and he said, I could go for some Italian, right, when he woke up. And this is why, what we did right after that, do we have the slide? No. No, we killed the slide. We did a partnership with Olive Garden. And then we took the Bud Knight immediately to the Olive Garden. And then we had free beers for everybody because he did go to the Italian restaurant, right? And then we brought it all to life and there was a lot of people at the Olive Garden and everything. All right, so that was the point. So I guess we've been having fun with this for the last 3 years. Have a smiling face there over there saying I'm over time. And so Bud Light, the consumption of Bud Light was like this. After this, it started to come back like this. So first, less negative. Now it's back to growth. Quality perceptions are up as well. So again, what we love, we're very passionate about this cases here because it's beer. Same brands, but brought to life in a totally different way and having people at the center of everything we do because we want to be relevant to them instead of just talking to ourselves. I think it's a big difference. Because I'm over time, I'm going to finish here. I had a few pages to talk about innovation and something that we did with Michelob Ultra Pure Gold and the organic beer that we launched, but I'm going to leave it for a second opportunity. If we have all together, then I would be more than glad to answer questions and hopefully we're going to meet again soon. Thank you very much.